Hello, and welcome to our session today, talking about the predictions of 2025 and the impacts of application development and networking. My name is Paul Nashawaty. I'm the practice lead and principal analyst for the AppDev practice at theCUBE Research, and I'm joined today by Bob. Bob, why don't you introduce yourself?
Hey, Paul. Thanks for having me on. So, Bob Laliberte, I am the principal analyst covering the networking space at theCUBE Research.
Bob, there's really exciting times in the application and networking world and what we're seeing in 2025. The impacts of AI, consolidation of platforms, you know, productivity changes, security and low code are really kind of top of mind. These are areas that application modernization are really taking off for organizations, and there's a tremendous amount of impact for organizations trying to modernize and optimize their environments. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, I think, you know, for sure, there's a lot going on right now. And the really interesting part about it is that it's not that there's a lot going on, but everything that's going on is happening at so much faster pace. We've seen the rate of acceleration of innovation happening. It's just so much faster than it is now than it was 5 years ago, even 2 years ago. So organizations are always struggling to keep up. And as each new technology, as each new innovation comes into the play, it's going to, right, obviously take some time to get comfortable, to validate it. It's going to potentially drive some complexity. So organizations really need solutions that are going to help them optimize their environments, to help drive that productivity, and to help organizations have a clearer picture of the entire environment.
Absolutely, Bob. And let's double click down into some of these areas. Well, one of the areas that really stands out to me is the fact that AI is going to augment development and really is going to help achieve those achieve scale for those organizations that are trying to drive forward. What I predict and what I see in our research is at least organizations were going to attempt to replace 50% of their developers with AI-driven systems, and they'll fail, right? And because these systems are not really set up for to remove the human out of the loop, but we're trying to move fast, to your point, right? Trying to change rapidly and try to be in front of it. So when we look at the impacts of using AI to augment development efforts and initiatives, what are the AI impacts on the networking side?
Yeah, there's a lot of impact on the AI side, you know, from an AI perspective. And we have it two ways. There's AI for networking, and then there's networking for AI. The first part, AI for networking, is all about AI ops. And it's all about how do network operations teams leverage this AI technology to enable them to do their job more efficiently. As these networks become far more distributed, right? Multiple public clouds, going out to now driving back to a lot of the private data centers for AI, edge locations, colo. And then that's not even to mention what's going on within the modern apps and what's happening at that level with mesh networks and so forth. So trying to manage these environments is becoming increasingly complex. So they're becoming more reliant on and embracing more these AI ops capabilities. Now, it's still fairly early, and the technology obviously leads the cultural aspect of it. So people are weary of these tools giving them recommendations and automating things fully. So there's going to be a process that has to, like an onboarding process, if you will, where organizations are able to check the efficacy of these solutions, make sure they are doing the right thing and that they're not automating a fault. So that's on one side of it. The other side of it is the whole networking for AI. That is driving a whole new set of infrastructure and data centers and creation of data centers to support these training and sometimes even the inferencing models and so forth. Maybe some of those are more at the edge, but it's really driving that really high performant, high speed network having to go into place. And it's critical that that can't go down because the training and inferencing needs to be done at a rapid pace. So it's really imperative that these AI ops tools are not only in that regular network, but also in this AI data center as well.
Bob, that makes a lot of sense. I don't think organizations are ready to take a human out of the loop at this point. I think Correct. That there's definitely like the impact of utilizing these tools for increasing productivity, but also making sure that, you know, you're going to push the big green button to make sure it works. And a human's going to do that, right? It's not yes. going to remove that person at this point in time. Maybe in the future, but not right now. That's my take.
It's the closed loop systems is what they refer to them as, right? Ensuring that there's always someone in the loop to validate, yes, this was what it was. And even if it's fully automated, to come back with that closed loop and say, hey, we automated this, but we're letting you know, this is what we detected, this is what we did. And then here was the result. We validated it's operating as it should be after the fact.
Absolutely. And it shows a lot of promise, right? And part of what you also touched on here is complexity, right? And that's an area that I would say, but based on the research that I find, is by the end of 2025, we're going to see that 50% of organizations are going to abandon managing those individual best of breed DevOps tools in favor of a unified platform, right? And this is going to your point, Bob, which is the need to for organizations to reduce the operational complexity, streamline workflows, and improve integration, right? And part of that is not just about the DevOps tools and the platform, but also how those tools are in the CI/CD pipeline and across the SDLC are working as integration points throughout the entire infrastructure as well. So when we tie those, that consolidation, are we seeing the same type of shift on the networking side with full stack solutions versus individual tools?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we're starting to see more and more of the networking companies driving to a platform-based approach. There's been some, you know, Extreme just launched one most recently comes to mind. You've got organizations like Juniper driving their AI engine across their entire portfolio of solutions. You've got people like Arista that have their common operating system across their entire portfolio. And you're seeing, you know, things, you know, Cisco starting to drive that productization under G2 as well. So there's a clear recognition that the environments need to be simpler to operate. The way to do that is what I usually refer to as the principle of least astonishment. So when you go from one network domain to the other, it's comfortable, it's familiar. You know how, what buttons to push and what to do to get the answers you need. So I think organizations, especially the network vendors themselves, are pushing really hard on doing this platform-based approach to drive the simplicity. And, you know, at the extreme of that is, are things like Meter and Nile that are doing it as a service and really incorporating and simplifying the solutions.
So simplifying the solution reduces the complexity, but it increases productivity, right? And what we're seeing is developers on the, from developer side, is developers today report that they're only spending 24% of their time writing code. Right. Yeah. And they're spending the remaining parts of their day doing things like ancillary tasks like designing and testing and debugging and stakeholder meetings. And I think that tying back to the AI front, that's where the automation kind of comes in and allows for that productivity increases. Do we see the same level of demand from the networking vendors looking for that productivity increase?
Yeah, I would say so. And it's more from the, not so much of a development perspective, but from the operation side, where the environment has gotten so much more distributed and so much more complex. The last survey we did, 80% of organizations came and said their network environment is more complex than it was 2 years ago. And that's driven by the increase in data, right? It's death, taxes, and data growth now are the only certainties in life. So a lot more data growth, a lot more distributed nature, a lot more complexity. So in order to be more productive and focus on the innovations that they want to bring into it, they don't want to spend all their time firefighting, fixing config changes, things like that. So that's where that AIOps really comes in. And when we've asked them in the past, what are you using the AIOps? What are the benefits from it? You know, you consistently get, it's so much faster to find and fix problems. So instead of running around with their hair on fire, they're able to really focus on driving innovation. And even, you know, tying it back to the developers, being able to take the time to build the guardrails to give those services to the developers to run between, right? Say, you can do anything between these guardrails. Go ahead. Have at it. Don't even need to talk to us.
Yeah, I mean, that's true. And, you know, and I think that there's a lot of impact to what we see in our research, right? To what you were talking about with these different complexity, and we talk about productivity improvements and the consolidation of efforts to reduce that complexity. We find that in 2024, leading up to 2024, that 75% of our respondents in our recent survey indicated that they're using 6 to 15 different tools to find out those the insights to the organization. Lots happening there. So, but you touched on something that's really interesting to me, which is, you know, with the data being the new kind of lifeline of the business, and I dare I say the data being the new oil type of thing. But basically, you know, we see that supply chain is attack and zero day vulnerability increases. We see also that 60 60% of organizations will embed DevSecOps practices as a fundamental requirement in their organizations. So the consolidation of these tools to reduce the complexity, where organizations are trying to increase that level of security, they're adding things like automation of vulnerability scanning, continuous compliance monitoring, security training embedded into the CI/CD pipeline to really protect those applications throughout the infrastructure. Yeah. What does that mean from the networking side?
Yeah, I mean, from the networking side, there's been an ongoing drive to try and have greater convergence between the network and security teams. Obviously, with all the data traversing the network, it's a great place to be able to identify threats, detect them, and respond to them as well. And so this whole, you know, obviously vendors dedicated to doing that specifically, but what we start seeing, you know, some of the trends, it's been 5 years now since SASE was introduced, and you're seeing more and more organizations looking to have that single vendor, that single platform, to be able to drive greater security across these highly distributed environments. And in addition to distributing the security out to all the locations, we're also seeing a lot of distributed services with companies like Pensando and Nitro Cards and things like that, driving the security deeper into the data center and being able to even look at that east-west traffic and so forth, and not just the north-south. Because, and then the other big piece on from a networking perspective is through that zero trust and basically micro segmentation. So if there is, and as inevitably it happens, a breach, how do you contain it and limit the blast radius to as small a possible area?
So there's definitely intricacies between the networking, say service mesh and API management gateways through the security protocols across the SDLC. And there's that's why it's important that we have this kind of collaboration and this discussion here, because the app dev side and the networking side really play very closely together. If you build an application in a silo and there's no communications outside of that silo, it's worthless, right? You know, but so like this is where, you know, I think you and I kind of work very closely together with our clients, and we go out there and we talk to them about the overall picture of where organizations are going.
Absolutely. I was just going to say the other thing, you know, we're starting to see emerging. You're going to see more about post-quantum cryptography as well. Right. So it, once you get to that stage, how do you, for security perspective, with this data traversing the network, how do you unencrypt it so you can see what's actually there? Because they're thinking that might be the next stage where these attackers start putting their threats into in post, you know, the PQC traffic. So.
Yeah. And as we're talking about future trends, like that's absolutely, I call it future, but it's really not that far out. Right. It's something that organizations need to be aware of. One of the things that I see from a future perspective is, and this is more near term, is, you know, as we kind of get into the last part of the topics here, is the accelerated growth of applications being developed within organizations. And that's pushing the need for those application development to happen at the kind of the citizen developer level, right? So the need for low code and no code expansion will really transform roles, right? So you're going to have the citizen developer, you know, taking on those responsibilities. You mentioned those guardrails, right? Put the guardrails in place and let the developers go at it. Well, what we're seeing is 30% of organizations will grow in these organizations using low code and no code platforms, empowering those citizen developers to take on the routine tasks that application developers are doing today, right? And I think that's a big factor, especially when you start combining everything that we talked about with the reduction of tools, optimizing the efficiencies, as well as having the communications across the different levels of applications. It really does all play nicely together. Right. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, no, it certainly does. And it's funny that you bring all that up, because I was just speaking with one of the more innovative kind of NAS companies called Meter, and they actually created, leveraging generative AI, the ability for anyone who's their customer to create new dashboards. So instead of going through a product management request process and going in and maybe having to pay for that engineering, et cetera, they're able to now, leveraging Gen AI, just say, hey, I'd like to look at this, and have it generate its own little dashboard within the system. So there's a clear need for organizations to be able to move more quickly, right? So in that case, you're taking a development process when the past would have been the initial request, going through product management, getting it prioritized, putting it on the development list, waiting for a release for it to come out, right? So nominally 6 months, 12 months, something maybe longer even for something like that to be reduced down to about 2 minutes. So that ability to have those no code, low code environments for people to develop, even on the networking side, not just for the applications, is certainly going to be something that will be a game changer.
Yeah, and I also see this trend will really force the professional developers to focus more on governance and complex integration as well as advanced customization, right? And really that's going to elevate their organizational role. So there's a lot there to happen. I definitely am excited about 2025, the growth of what's happening. Bob, parting moments here. Anything else you want to leave the audience with?
I think it's going to be an exciting year. There's a lot going on, especially in the network industry. There's a lot of big changes at Cisco. You've got the HPE Juniper merger that may or may not take place. People are still waiting to see. So a lot of upstarts, right, that are coming up with some great new technology. Companies like Arista driving these AI data centers. So just a lot going on. And like I said, the pace of acceleration is definitely picking up. So pace of innovation is accelerating, I should say. Easy for me to say, right? So I'm really looking forward to, as each year goes by, we're seeing just more and more innovation being brought to the market.
Yeah, no, I couldn't agree more. And actually, what I see is there's a lot happening across the CNCF landscape on the application development side. There's a lot more integration. I always talk about past, present, and future when I'm talking about applications. We can't abandon what's happening in the past because those have to be modern. Those applications need to be modernized. But we're looking at tech trends like what's happening with Kubernetes, what's happening with orchestration, what's happening with WebAssembly and WASM and where that's going. So there's a lot happening here. And I think that this is the year that a lot of this stuff is going to kind of mature and become more available for the market. Bob, it is great to be talking with you. Great to be working with you on these projects. And great to have you on in your insights on what's going on in 2025. Thank you for your time today. And I also want to thank the audience for watching our episode here. There's a lot happening, a lot more to unpack here. So feel free to reach out to Bob and myself, and we'll be happy to continue the dialogue there. Thank you and have a great day.